Hi everyone. Today in this video we are going to discuss about lithium induced diabetes insipidus and hyponatremia. How lithium can produce one of the condition nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. And we will also discuss how this lithium can increase natriuresis resulting in loss of sodium. What is this lithium? Lithium is one of the drug which is used as anti-manic agent. Particularly, this drug can be used in the bipolar depressive disorder where the patient can have the two phases, both mania as well as depression, and mood swings can be observed from mania to depression as well as from depression to mania. In such conditions, lithium can be used in order to decrease the manic phase in the patients. Interestingly, lithium is one of the lightest metal which can be used as a drug, and it can be combined with a carbonate where the lithium can form a salt with carbonate resulting in lithium carbonate. Now this lithium carbonate is used as anti-manic agent. But this lithium can produce a significant effect on the renal system. So when this lithium is used, it can produce three polys in the patients. First one is the polyuria. This is the condition of diluted urine with excess urinary volume. Generally, this condition can be observed in the diabetic patients with diabetes insipidus. And here the adult urinary volume may be excreted greater than 3 liters. And second poly condition is the polydipsia. Since more amount of water is going to be excreted within the urine, it results in the decreased water levels within the body, leading to increased thirst in the patients. So this condition is called as polydipsia. Similarly, lithium can also produce polyphagia, increased appetite, which may result in the weight gain in the patients. So these are very significant effects of lithium, because lithium is one of the drug which is having the narrow therapeutic window, and a small increment in serum lithium levels may lead to increased toxicity. So today in this video, we are going to discuss how this lithium can increase the polyuria, and it can produce hyponatremia as well as nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Just we have discussed that lithium can produce nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. This is the condition where we can observe increased urinary volume with increased amount of water resulting in the diluted urine. Generally, water is going to be reabsorbed at the collecting tubules by vasopressin, which is known as antidiuretic hormone. Due to this hormonal activity, most of the water in the filtrate is going to be reabsorbed, which produce a concentrated urine. But when this lithium is used, lithium can inhibit the activity of antidiuretic hormone, which results in the diluted urine. And along with loss of water, sodium is also going to be excreted, which results in the increased natriuresis. And when the sodium is lost, it also promotes the excretion of bicarbonate. So both sodium, water as well as bicarbonate are excreted when lithium is administered. And when the bicarbonate is more excreted, the proton levels within the body are elevated, which results in hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. In this way, lithium can increase the natriuresis, which finally results in metabolic acidosis. So all these conditions are interrelated with the action of lithium on renal system. Now let us see how lithium can produce hyponatremia as well as diabetes insipidus. So this is the proximal convoluted tubule, and this is basolateral membrane, and this is the apical membrane, that is the inner membrane of the lumen. Now within the filtrate, sodium is present, which is going to be reabsorbed at the proximal convoluted tubule. Here the sodium can be absorbed at the apical membrane for the exchange of protons. So here one of the pump is present, sodium proton exchange pump. Through this pump, sodium can enter into the renal tubules for the exchange of proton. This is the normal condition where the sodium is exchanged for the proton. But when the lithium is administered into the body, this lithium is also present in the filtrate, because lithium and sodium are equally charged and they belong to the same group in the periodic table. So these ions behave in a similar way. Now lithium can also enter into the renal tubules for exchange of proton by the same pump, sodium hydrogen exchange pump. But the transport of lithium is somewhat slow compared with the sodium. Now both lithium as well as sodium are present within the renal jugular membrane. Now they should be reabsorbed into the systemic circulation, which require another pump, sodium potassium ATPase pump. So this pump can exchange the sodium for the exchange of potassium, and which requires the energy. Since the lithium and sodium are acting in a similar way, the same pump is also responsible for transport of lithium into the systemic circulation. Now here lithium can be exchanged for the potassium so that lithium can be entered into the systemic circulation. But for this exchange, energy is required in the form of ATP, and ATP is converted into ADP. So this reabsorption of lithium is an energy dependent process. But when the lithium levels are excessively increased, the sodium potassium ATPase pump cannot transport more amount of the lithium into the systemic circulation, so that lithium is accumulated within the renal tubules, but it is not reabsorbed into the systemic circulation. In this way, lithium is more accumulated into the renal tubules, as the transport of lithium at basolateral membrane is an energy dependent process. Now, in presence of lithium, sodium is not reabsorbed and sodium is excreted within the urine. So this results in the hyponatremia. Increased excretion of sodium results in the decreased sodium levels within the blood. Similarly, at the correct intubules, lithium can also show another activity. So again, this is basolateral membrane and this is the apical membrane. Apical membrane is expressed with one of the sodium channels, epithelial sodium channels. Through this epithelial or renal tubular sodium channel, sodium can enter into the renal tubules, where it is going to be reabsorbed into the systemic circulation. But again here, lithium can compete with the sodium. Now, lithium can enter into the collecting tubular membrane through these epithelial sodium channels. Then it can target the reabsorption of water at the collecting tubules. For the reabsorption of water, one of the hormone is going to act, that is the vasopressin. Vasopressin can act on the V2 channels, which are coupled with G protein coupled receptors such as alpha, beta, gamma. And V2 receptors are G alpha S, that means they are stimulatory in nature and working through alpha subunit. Now when this vasopressin binds to V2 receptors, it can stimulate the adenylyl cyclase system, which can convert the ATP into one of the important secondary messenger, cyclic AMP. This cyclic AMP then stimulates protein kinase A, which are the phosphorylating enzymes, and this group of enzymes can produce some gene transcription and protein synthesis, and they can increase the expression of few of the proteins. These are the aquaporins. Now these aquaporins can be expressed on the apical membrane, and these are the aquaporin type 2 channels. Similarly, other type of aquaporins are expressed on the basolateral membrane, such as AQP3R4. Now the water molecules can enter into the renal tubules through these aquaporins. Then they are reabsorbed into the systemic circulation again through another aquaporins expressed on basolateral membrane. In this way, water can be reabsorbed by the action of the hormone vasopressin. But in presence of lithium, the action of vasopressin is going to be modulated. This lithium can inhibit the cyclic AMP activity, resulting in the inhibition of cyclic AMP pathway as well as reduced expression of aquaporins. Now, in presence of lithium, water cannot be reabsorbed and it is excreted within the urine. So, this condition results in the increased urinary volume with more dilution, leading to polyuria as well as polydipsia. Now, lithium can show two types of activities. Lithium can produce hyponatremia. Since lithium competes with the sodium, sodium is not reabsorbed. Instead, lithium is more reabsorbed into the renal tubules. By this, lithium can reduce the sodium reabsorption, resulting in decreased serum sodium levels. Similarly, lithium can also produce nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. So, lithium can produce excretion of diluted urine with increased urinary volume. As we have discussed earlier, this action of lithium is mainly due to inhibitory effect on antidiuretic hormone activity. So, when the lithium levels are excessively increased, it can produce both hyponatremia as well as nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. But interestingly, this hyponatremia can further increase the diabetes insipidus produced by lithium. When there is decreased serum sodium levels, it increases the accumulation of lithium within the renal tubules, So renal accumulation of lithium is increased, which further enhances nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. So generally hyponatremic conditions further increase the lithium toxicity. So when the lithium is given with other diuretics such as loop diuretics and tiazide diuretics, which produce further hyponatremia resulting in enhanced lithium toxicity. And this is more important because lithium is a drug with narrow therapeutic window. The normal therapeutic range of lithium is variable from 0.8 to 1.2 milliequivalents per liter. But when these lithium levels are increased greater than 1.5 milliequivalents per liter, it can produce some lithium toxicity, resulting in polyuria, polydipsia, polyphagia, as well as renal tubular damage, nephritis, and a severe nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. So that's about the mechanism behind lithium-induced diabetes insipidus and hyponatremia. So that's for today. Hope you have enjoyed this video. If you like this video, please subscribe to our channel. Share this video with your friends. Post your comments in the comment box. Thank you for watching this video.